to our special Best of Shop Talk episode. I'm Maria Tanwatko Trillo. What business to start? Do I have what it takes to be an entrepreneur? And what franchise ideas are profitable? We always get a lot of those business-related questions, and to answer them, we brought on the show this year entrepreneurship and franchising gurus. Among them, Professor Jay Bernardo, who talked about developing the entrepreneurial mindset, and early this year, Rudolf Kotick, who enumerated some of the pitfalls in franchising.
The entrepreneurial character is one that always seeks for new things. He looks at situations and then he tries to dissect it and sees the opportunities rather than the problems itself.
Okay.
He's the type of person that would, he's not really competing with other people. Not like in corporate life, you compete with your peers in order to get the next position. But the entrepreneur looks for, he's competing with himself. He wants to be better the next time. He wants to come up with something better for his enterprise and for whatever he's offering out there. This is the type of person that he's not only looking at what he did yesterday, he wants to see what he's going to be doing tomorrow. That's the character that he has, and he's always trying to become innovative and creative in that process.
Right. Okay. And you also talk about the three aspects of this entrepreneurial character. You have to master yourself, master situations, and master your enterprise.
Yes. By knowing who you are, and you see, like some people say, yeah, I'm not too enterprising. Can I be an entrepreneur? By knowing who you are, we try to suggest to you what type of business or type of entrepreneurship you could get into. For example, some people are not very creative. You have the choice of developing your creative side, or you could go into a franchise. Mm-hmm. A franchise would actually make you buy a business and then run the business in that context. That's the mastery of self. If you're very creative, then franchising will not work for you. You will always try to break the rules of the game. And then there's the mastery situation, wherein you become very good in opportunity seeking. Whenever you see an industry or you try to find out a particular industry that you're going to go into, you will be able to see the opportunity behind it. And then the master, being a master of the enterprise, means that you know the functions, which is marketing and mm-hmm. and operations and finance and HR. You know the functions in which an enterprise has to run. So. Mm-hmm. These three characteristics, these three masteries, is the one that builds the entrepreneur. If I'll just add some more.
Sure.
Whenever people ask me, how do you determine whether a particular venture could be successful or not? We tell them it's like a tripod. There's three pillars. One is you have to know whether you're passionate about it. Mm-hmm. The other one is there a market behind it? And the third one is, can you deliver consistently the product or service that is being required to you? And basically, the mastery of self brings about the passion, the mastery of situation brings about the market, and the mastery of the enterprise brings about the delivery process.
Okay,
so
they're all related.
All are there. Without any of the three, then the business will fail.
Right. Okay, let's go through. There, we have it on the screen right there.
Yes.
Okay, so you have to have the passion, right? And that includes knowing yourself well. Mastering the situation is seeing the opportunities and, as you said, creating the market. And mastering the enterprise is being able to run the business successfully so you can produce your product or your services as required. And you get all those three in the middle and you have one happy entrepreneur.
That's right.
Right? Okay. I'm looking at something here you said earlier. In order to be self-mastered, you say you don't need an especially high IQ. Really?
Yeah. Not like IQ is not the determinant of success as far as entrepreneurs are concerned. There are a lot of entrepreneurs who do not even have formal education. Mm-hmm. But they are good in analyzing situations. They are good with relating to the market, or they are good as inspiring employees. For IQ is not the key. It's really more of EQ and AQ. EQ means emotional quotient, which means how you relate to people, customers, employees, how you inspire them and lead them and manage them. And AQ is adversity quotient, which means how you deal with crisis, how you deal with failure, how you deal with situations changing. So being good in that, in EQ and AQ, is the one that really makes you become a better entrepreneur than the IQ side.
Okay, so how do you actually develop that? It sounds great, and I want to have it. And I'm sure everyone out there wants to have it. But how do you actually create that part of yourself?
First is the acknowledgement first of the type of personality that you have, and to find out which you need to develop in order for you to become successful in business. Once you're able to discover this, we bring you through several different types of workshops and exams, and you will have a self-discovery. And after that self-discovery, you, based on what you're passionate about, then you would we would be able to determine what's the gaps and how we will able to bring you to that side, you know, to becoming a more self-mastered person.
One pitfall would be, for example, if your franchise is not properly developed, meaning to say it was not developed by a professional franchise consultant. You did it by your own, for example, and you actually have no idea what franchising is all about.
Right.
And then some people do that. They go into franchising without the actual professional knowledge, and then they go into franchising and get franchisees.
Right.
And the franchise is actually quite often also on a loss because the franchisor cannot treat them in the way they should be treated because they are not professional franchisors.
So what are one of the key factors then that a franchisee can look for in a franchisor that is a telltale sign that they're not professionally developed then?
That's right. I mean, a lot of those companies which have not the service of a franchise consultant actually not professionally developed. Therefore, that could be one of the pitfalls for the franchise buyers, because they don't know what they're actually buying. If that is a real franchise, if that is real, properly done, the system standards are properly there, if the legal is properly worked out, if they have an operations manual, and all of those things which are required in a franchise. The franchise disclosure information is not required by the DTI, so we really encourage people, if they want to get a franchise, they should ask the franchisor to ask for it. Of course, they won't be immediately handed it out. If you want to become a franchisee, before you can get the franchise disclosure information, you have to submit also your confidential questionnaire to the franchisor. You have to send a letter of intent.
So you have to show that you're serious first
to show that you want to be a professional franchisee also. So you lay your cards on the table, and then the franchisor will do the same.
Okay.
They will give you the FDI, which contains a copy of the franchise agreement, which contains a copy of the memorandum of agreement, which contains a background of the franchisor, which contains a listing of the existing franchisees, which contains also how much investment a franchisee will have to spend, what financials he can expect, estimated P&L, so to speak.
So then generally,
all of that is in the franchise disclosure information.
The business advice we got was not just for grown-ups, but for future entrepreneurs as well. Mary Joy Abakin shared with us the importance of raising entrepreneurs. Now, based on your book, what are your suggestions for raising an entrepreneurial child?
Well, I think as a parent, the first thing that you should really look at is your child's strengths, as I've said. Know your child, discover what they can do, and then give them opportunity accordingly. Like, in my case, I'm not very strong in music, but my two kids are very strong in music.
Okay.
So they like composing songs, they like playing instruments. So unless I'm aware that my kids are different from me, I'm never gonna give them that kind of opportunity because I don't think it's important. So I think the parent has to be attuned to what the child's strengths are to be able to give opportunities. And second, to really, in your household, encourage creativity and innovation.
How can you do that?
In very simple things, you know. When for example, my daughter one time, she was listening to, it was a pitch to ask for scholarships in her parish. Okay, and she's a little girl, and she was saying, how much is that? And I was like, you know, she goes, how much do I have to save every day? I go, 20 pesos, and you can send the child to school. And she's like, that's my ice cream. So she was saying, in her head, because you bother to explain how things work. You know, she can never compute that big amount, but when she realized 20 pesos is my ice cream that I eat every day, I don't mind sacrificing that.
Okay, and something she can quantify.
Yes, and then she can use it to problem solve. She says, another kid can't go to school, and if I just give up my ice cream, there's enough 20 pesos to put together to make this happen. And so it's really empowering kids, and that happens when you communicate with them. So listen to their ideas, because sometimes initially you'll think, oh, you know, how big or how strange, but actually they can be very good ideas once you